This is a story of courage. This is the story of a group of young men who, against formidable odds, discovered the secret of teamwork and the secret of winning. Dedicating body and soul to the common goal, the Cowboys of Oklahoma State University rode their way to a winning season that was capped in the Houston Astrodome on New Year's Eve. Who are these young men who provide countless thrills to their legions of fans on Saturdays? Who are the coaches who lend their wisdom and leadership to this team to mold it into a force to be dealt with in the Big Eight Conference? What is the heart and desire that has made this team strive boldly to establish itself as one of the best football teams in all of America? As you will find out, wearing the orange and black of the Cowboys is a mark of pride and accomplishment. Oklahoma State football players have shown that with love, unity, and hard work, everything is possible. This is their story. Oklahoma State University is one of the most respected academic institutions in the country. With over 1,100 full-time teaching faculty, OSU is committed to the excellence of its 23,000 students.
When I think about our student athletes, I think, you know, the most important thing, as far as I'm concerned, is their academics. I know I go into the homes and I talk to a lot of mothers and daddies about, you know, their sons coming to Oklahoma State University, and I sincerely tell them that, you know, we stress academics. It's very, very important.
The importance of obtaining a college degree cannot be overestimated. Being a Cowboy means holding your head high both on and off the field. Having faith in yourself is the key to success. In the beginning of the 1983 season, few experts believed that Oklahoma State would be a great team. In fact, the press predicted OSU to finish seventh in the Big Eight.
Really get into time up, really time up.
Graduation and injury had depleted the ranks of battle-tested players. If speed and strength can be measured, then heart and desire cannot. And the Cowboys had plenty of heart.
No side tackling. Here we go, right shoulder.
Perhaps more important, they had leadership. The coaching staff instilled a mixture of humility and bravado in the players that made them clear-thinking and hard-hitting.
Here we go. On the first side. Come on, David. Elbows in. Let's do it right.
It was a formula that was to lead to an exciting 8-4 season. But there was one man who tied all of the diverse parts of this football team together. With a mixture of brilliance and good old common sense, head coach Jimmy Johnson molded the Cowboys into his kind of football team. Fun, fast, and fantastic. For the players, Jimmy Johnson served as a role model that inspired them to become better players and better people.
Nice throw, Rusty.
He's always positive. That's the thing I think that's really the key for us. He's always positive, and that rubs off on us. He actually believes that that we can do anything.
Well, as a coach, he's a great motivator, and as a person, he's probably one of the most classiest guys that you ever meet. And I really like him. I mean, just being around him will rub off on you, because that's what type of guy he really is.
To put it in one word, I'd probably call him a motivator. He gets a lot of work out of us. You can look at individuals on our team, and myself for one, you know, I don't have the great talent that many other players have, but he seems to get more out of us than what we're capable of doing, it seems like, at times. So, you know, I really respect that.
In 1983, OSU home attendance hit an all-time high of 49,000 per game, and there were good reasons. Jimmy Johnson's football team was exciting to watch. the Oklahoma State Cowboys gained more respect each week they played. When Heisman Trophy candidate Ernest Anderson was sidelined with injuries, the offense was left with no big-name stars, no all-conference players, and few seniors. But that didn't seem to deter them. Senior offensive captain Kevin Igo knew that unity would conquer adversity.
I'm in the offensive line, so I know the closeness in there. We're a bunch of brothers. It's a fraternity in the offensive line. We stand up for each other. We don't cut each other down. We know what it takes to do the job, and it's something that you can't explain because there's just so much closeness there.
The offensive line busted open holes for junior Sean Jones to the tune of 956 yards. Bearing the bulk of the running chores, Jones garnered AP All-Big Eight honors along with Nebraska's Mike Rozier. For players like split end Jamie Harris, OSU's offense is a treat.
Well, it's pretty exciting. I mean, I try to go out and play the game with a lot of emotion, and that really boosts my emotion whenever I can get in that end zone. So I like getting in there just because of the emotional aspect of it.
Jamie and his pals confounded the Big Eight Conference with their scoring punch. The team was equally tough on the ground and through the air. And as always, they gave every ounce of effort in every play. Even though he had more than his share of injuries in 1983, a pulled groin muscle, an ulcer, and an ankle injury, All-American Ernest Anderson contributed greatly to OSU's success. Anderson rammed and finessed his way to over 600 vital yards. Defensive end Harry Roberts doubled as the kick return specialist. And with runs like this 90-yard return against Missouri, the special teams were dangerous. Even though the fans love offense, coaches know that it's defense that wins or loses games. The 1983 edition of the Cowboy defense sparkled. However, few would have predicted their success in the preseason. The year before, the team had the worst turnover ratio in the entire nation. In 83, Coach Johnson switched quarterback Adam Hines to free safety, and running back Harry Roberts moved to defensive end. The switches were baffling, but somehow it all worked like a well-oiled machine.
One of the goals that we had set for ourselves as a team in 1983 was to cause some things to happen defensively with the turnovers, and it's just a compliment to our assistant coaches that they worked so hard to reverse the trend that we had in 1982. On the defensive side of the ball, we led the nation in total turnovers. We had 26 interceptions, which led the nation. We had 27 fumbles recovered, which led the nation, and had a total of 53 turnovers caused by our defense, and that's because they were so aggressive.
They were aggressive, but they were also fast. No one on the defense ran the 40 slower than 4.7 seconds. There were no slowpokes on this defensive team.
We ended up ninth in the country in scoring defense, and it was a really fun group to watch because they were very, very aggressive. They had great quickness, and they really swarmed the football. And if I had to say any one thing that really described our 1983 defense is they really got after it with great intensity, and is one of the most fun defensive teams I've ever had since I've been coaching.
the defense's record stands by itself. Four consecutive times, an OSU player was voted Big 8 Defensive Player of the Week. Sophomore tackle Leslie O'Neill was consensus All Big 8. The Cowboys held their opponents to their lowest scoring total in 16 seasons and ranked 8th nationally in rushing defense and 9th in scoring defense. Walk-on Matt Munger led the team in tackles with 150, and newly switched safety Adam Hines led the Big 8 in interceptions with 8. For the coaches and the fans, the defense was a work of art and a thing of great beauty. For toppling so many opponents, the Cowboys were rewarded by an invitation to the Bluebonnet Bowl. The bowl in Houston featured much more than a football game against Baylor University. It was a time to enjoy the successes of the season, a time to relax with old friends and share some new good times. The Cowboys were treated royally. A trip to the rodeo was highlighted by a visit from former OSU and Dallas Cowboy great Walt Garris.
What's that mud about?
I got to pull for the Cowboys. Always.
I heard
my team. I'm just glad they started winning up right now.
Well, we got some good players now.
Yeah, that's true.
They had little old guys like you playing fullback back years ago.
Although there were a lot of festivities, the Bluebonnet Bowl also had its serious side. Each year, the bowl is dedicated to a different charity, and both teams visit local hospitals. For the Cowboys, their visit was a touching experience.
This is going to be the Baylor Bear right here. Okay, block the Baylor Bear. Yeah! Yeah! It's Matt Munger.
Matt Munger, Lewis. Nice to meet you.
You gonna watch the ball game Saturday night?
I might go.
All right,
yeah,
that'd be great. I root for Oklahoma State now.
Oh, I know.
Okay, wear your t-shirt.
Yeah.
The chance to bring a smile to a young person's face made the trip to Houston more than worthwhile. As the last moon of 1983 rose over Houston's skyline, the coaches and players turned their attention to the Astrodome and the Baylor Bears. Everyone knew that the Bears were not to be taken lightly. They had an explosive offense and had finished tied for third in the Southwest Conference. Although Baylor had the hottest quarterback tandem in the nation, OSU quarterback Rusty Hilger was unfazed.
We're going to come out and we're going to play lights out football to the end. You know, everybody here wants it, and what they want, we've come to believe we can get.
With a sellout crowd of over 50,000 in the stands, the Pokes made final preparations.
This is the last time some of you guys will have a football uniform on. Let's give it your all. Offense, execute. Defense, swarm the football, and press the kicking game. Let's not leave that field with anything on it. Give it your all. Let's go.
Let's go. Go.
For head coach Jimmy Johnson and his players, this was the moment to show a national audience the Oklahoma State Cowboys were not just a good team, they were a great team. Oklahoma State opened the game decisively. After stopping the Bears' first drive, Rusty Hilger hit Malcolm Lewis down the sideline for 17. Rusty then threw against the grain to Lewis, who had clear sailing for the touchdown. The extra point attempt was blocked, but the offensive coaches kept their players focused on their technique.
I would worry about staying on number one. Yeah. You see, I mean, even if you're back a little bit, you're on. Yeah. It's a big deal, okay?
One of these, whoever's in the ball game, tailback will have a chance to be open right there because they just read it.
Ernest Anderson's first run from scrimmage gobbled up 39 yards. Rusty spotted OSU's leading pass receiver, Jamie Harris, on the right sideline. And Jamie ran it down to the one.
This may be the most important series, the whole ball game. We have to put this one in the end zone. We have to put it in the end zone. You block it.
Ernest Anderson opened the second quarter with his touchdown dive. The two-point conversion to Lewis was as good as gold. With a quick 14-0 lead, it was time for the defense to make sure that the Bears stayed in the hole. Sophomore nose guard John Washington gave quarterback Cody Carlson a taste of Oklahoma State defense. Just as they had done all year, the Cowboys caused turnovers by their aggressive pursuit. Free safety Rod Brown recovered a fumble, and the offense was looking for seven more. Anderson kept the Pokes' offensive machine rolling with his 17-yard sprint. Then, with picture-perfect precision, Hilger dropped the pigskin into Jamie Harris's hands. This touchdown deserved a second look. But even while the Pokes were celebrating, Coach Johnson was worried. He didn't want his team to get overconfident. On the next series, the Bears drove back down the field, and Mighty Mike Gerald McNeil grabbed the touchdown. Then misfortune struck as Rusty Hilger took a monumental hit and had to leave the game with a concussion. Larry Roach's field goal widened the gap as the half ended, but everyone knew that the second half would be a completely different ball game. The first half had been an impressive one for the Cowboys. Rusty Hilger had gone 12 of 17 for 137 yards. But with Hilger questionable for the second half, every fan in the stadium and every fan throughout the national television audience was wondering if the Cowboys would buckle under the pressure or if they would rise to the occasion. Strong-armed quarterback Ike Jackson took over the offensive reins in the third quarter with confidence. When the tenacious Bears blocked Larry Roach's field goal attempt, the Cowboy defense had seen enough. If the first half would star the offense, then Chris Rockins, Leslie O'Neill, Matt Munger and company would be the stars of the second half. James Hamm put his number 40 on Baylor's quarterback as a prelude to the fun that was about to come.
Hey, if they no huddle us, it's still, we're going to be an okie go, strong drop, three heads up. Okay? If they no huddle us, we're going to stay in it.
Okay.
The coaching Adam Hines received paid dividends as the fourth quarter opened. He caught a rebound for a drive-stopping interception that really got the Pokes pumped up. Matt Munger, a walk-on starter and an academic all-conference, put his personal insignia on Baylor. Linebacker James Spencer picked off another pass to put the Bears' offense into hibernation. All-conference Leslie O'Neill's fourth down sack was the trigger to set off the victory celebration. The convincing 24-14 victory was a perfect reward for all the hard work, sweat, and love that the players, coaches, and fans had put forth all season. Being ranked as high as 14th in the national polls was a wonderful way to bring in the new year. As MVP Ernest Anderson was interviewed on TV, senior Roderick Fisher took the time to thank his teammates.
You know, we worked together as a unit, and we won this game as a unit. And you all will always have a place in my life, even when I leave here and delve in the business world or whatever. So, hey, it's been great playing with you guys. I love you. And, hey, you know, don't ever forget me because I'll never forget you. All right?
The story of the 1983 Oklahoma State Cowboys is one of courage and personal and team triumphs.
The progress we've made as a team is just phenomenal to me. I've never seen a group of kids so young and so inexperienced at what we've done turn out to be such players.
Coach Jimmy Johnson, the time spent being a Cowboy can be the greatest time of a young man's life.
The one thing that I want them to remember most, that Oklahoma State University gave them an opportunity to mature and to grow and to be a first-class citizen and to be the type of person that can go out into society and contribute and be a positive person and look back 10 and 15 years from now and say, hey, I'm very, very proud that I got my degree from Oklahoma State University. I was part of a successful football program, and I met many, many people, and I had some great experiences during my 4 years there in Stillwater, Oklahoma.
The 1984 Oklahoma State Cowboys provided the most exciting, record-breaking, spine-tingling year in the history of OSU football. This group of young men, through sheer will and determination, catapulted themselves into the national spotlight. Before the season kicked off, few would have dreamt of the greatness that this team would achieve. But during the 1984 season, the Cowboys grew into a team that dared to dream dreams. being a cowboy took on a greater meaning than simply wearing an Oklahoma State uniform. Being a cowboy meant being the best that you can be, both as a football player and as a student, and holding your head high. For quarterback Rusty Hilger, being a cowboy is something special.
Being a cowboy and putting on the uniform every day has meant a lot to me. It's given me some of the foundations that I'll live my life through, and being a winner and striving hard to in what you believe in. I tell you, when you put on the orange and black and go out and play on a Saturday afternoon when you're winning football games and you line it up against some of the best in the country, it's a really good feeling.
This positive feeling of success was nurtured by first-year head coach Pat Jones, who led Oklahoma State University with an honest, hard work approach.
Well, we knew we had a lot of players coming back, a lot of experienced players, and we felt we just needed that extra little touch. And I think Coach Jones brought that to us this year. He pushed us farther than we ever had pushed ourselves before, and you know, we needed that.
He's real straightforward, you know, extremely honest. He'll tell you whether good or bad, he'll tell you just how it is.
He's an excellent guy, just not as a coach, but as a person.
Through endless hours of hard work, Coach Jones fostered in the OSU football players a positive state of self-confidence and pride.
Well, I think cowboy football to me means working hard, doing the right things all the time, not part of the time. Doing everything you possibly can to make yourself a better person, academically, athletically, morally. You know, again, just having extra good habits and working yourself as hard as you can, trying to get everything out of yourself that you possibly can.
Trying to be the best that you can be paid big dividends this season as the Cowboys became the first OSU team to win 10 games in a single season. The season opened on a challenging note as the Cowboys ventured to Tempe, Arizona, to play the team picked by many to be national champions, the Arizona State Sun Devils.
Well, going into Arizona State game, we knew we had a good nucleus back coming off the big win last year in the Bluebonnet Bowl. Knew we had our work cut out for us at Tempe. They had the majority of their squad coming back, knew we were going to be in a hostile environment. Felt like we could win the game, but felt like it would go down late, you know, be a real close ball game.
On the first series, Leslie O'Neill slammed the Arizona State quarterback, and Rodney Harding escorted the ball into the end zone for the first 7 points of the season. Then, the Oklahoma State offense put on an impressive display of firepower as they systematically tore apart the highly touted Sun Devil defense. Charles Crawford ran in for a touchdown, and then Rusty Hilger hit Bobby Riley for 7 more. Charles Crawford gave a preview of the brilliant running that was in store for OSU fans. And Jamie Harris broke a big play. In the second half, Rusty punched it over the goal line, and Joe Miller ran over right guard to inflate the Cowboy tally to 45 points. The OSU defense was simply awesome that night. They manhandled Arizona State, holding them to a meager 3 points. Overall, the victory was very impressive, and it served notice that the Cowboys would be making their own march on the national championship.
Well, I knew that first game would be a big challenge for us. You know, they were picked number one and in the top 10 in most every poll. So if I thought our season would come down, you know, if how well we did that first game and winning by such a big margin, I knew there would be nothing but good things ahead of us.
The Cowboys solidified their position among the nation's elite teams with 5 early victories. Colorado provided the 4th of 8 television appearances for the Cowboys. Oklahoma State was firmly entrenched in the nation's top 20, and the players were enjoying and handling the media exposure.
Hand right, left, hand left, just a hair, Paul, good.
Unlock the camera.
This is your camera. That's our first happy guy of the day. Right.
Head coach Pat Jones and his staff were keeping the team on an even keel by keeping the players level-headed. In the tough Big 8 conference, any team can beat any other on any given Saturday. Coach Jones had his players primed and ready to put forth their best effort.
It'll take a lot of fanatical effort. That's one thing we have a lot of.
On the second play of the game, the defense pounded the Colorado runner and Rod Brown covered the loose ball. The offense took advantage of the turnover as they marched 30 yards downfield in five plays to make the score 7-0. Charles Crawford did the honors on this one-yard run. When the Buffaloes tied the score in the second quarter, it was time to regroup. The Cowboys did not panic, but stuck to their game plan. Give your best effort on every play and play smart and disciplined football. On the next series, after the Colorado touchdown, Rusty Hilger put the Cowboys in the lead again with this 47-yard strike. The score at halftime was 15-8, and Coach Jones kept his players' intensity level high as the decision still hung in the balance.
Let's go! Let's go! Hey, Mark Moore! Mark! Let's go now! Let's go now! Let's go now! How bad do you want it? How bad do you want it?
Leslie O'Neill and company punished the Colorado runners. Their unrelenting pressure led to a Rodney Harding safety. Larry Roach countered two Colorado field goals with this three-pointer to extend the lead to 20-14. With 1:21 on the clock, the defense rose to the occasion again to stop the final Buffalo drive. John Washington broke up this pass attempt, and then Leslie O'Neill gave Colorado a taste of his football philosophy.
I think you have to have a little bit of meanness in there. You just have to have a lot of will to get to the ball also.
The Cowboys' will and determination had led to another dramatic Big 8 conference victory. After thrashing Kansas State 34-6, OSU was back on national television to host the Missouri Tigers. In the first night game in almost 50 years, the Cowboys put together a solid winning effort. Led by Leslie O'Neill's blocked field goal, blocked extra point attempt, and 16 tackles, the defense destroyed the Tigers. Offensively, Oklahoma State ran like a well-oiled machine as they rolled to a 31-13 win. Oklahoma State rounded out the regular season with 9 victories and had climbed as high as number 2 in the national polls. They had gone so far because they had done it together as one proud team.
Well, I think the key to us having success this year has been our team attitude. We all played together, and we all, fought on the field together, so we all won and lost together. I think that was the key to our success this year is we all had team-oriented goals, and we all worked hard for those goals.
The Cowboy formula for success is by no means limited to the gridiron. It extends to every part of a student athlete's life in Stillwater, Oklahoma. Being a true success entails so much more than making tackles and catching passes. Being a success means improving your mind through a quality education, outstanding facilities, and a commitment to excellence ensures that every cowboy receives the highest quality education. The 23,000 students enjoy a low faculty-to-student ratio of 1 to 19. The student is treated as an individual and not as part of a crowd. The range of subjects is extensive and caters to a wide variety of interests. The university offers bachelor degrees in 94 major fields. OSU offers curriculums through its colleges of agriculture, arts and sciences, business administration, education, home economics, veterinary medicine, a graduate college, and the College of Engineering, Architecture, and Technology.
Reliance on symbolism and unconscious motives.
To begin our program, I'd like to turn to Marilyn Choike and ask her if she would...
Whether you are interested in learning how to operate a modern television station or helping to preserve America's natural resources, OSU offers you the opportunity to be the best that you can be.
Proportional plan. According to this plan, you would take the popular vote within a state, having eliminated the electors, and you would give the political party an electoral vote proportionate to the popular vote cast. Different districts in the state could be supporting different...
Whether candidates. You are behind the camera or in front of the camera, being a cowboy can help you be a success in life.
Okay, listen now. All right, from the opening kickoff, we're going to kick off and play defense. You got to want it more than they do. You got to want it more than they do. You got to be more enthusiastic than them. You got to play harder than them. Ever down. Ever down. All the way. If we want it bad enough, we'll win. Let's go.
The enthusiasm and positive energy that the football team generates has become an exciting part of life on the Stillwater campus. When the players take the field, they carry not only their own dreams of success, but the dreams of every cowboy fan. Football games in Stillwater are a happening. The night before homecoming, thousands walk around the streets to see the ingenious displays made by the fraternities, sororities, and independent residence halls.
Welcome here to Homecoming 1984.
Then the night really heats up as cowboy fans follow the band to Lewis Stadium for a spirited pep rally. In 1984, the Cowboys were inspired by their loyal fan support both at home and away. Of special note was the defense, who played like they had a mission to accomplish and a job to do. led by the outstanding defensive play and the solid offensive effort all year, the Oklahoma State Cowboys earned a postseason invitation to the prestigious Gator Bowl in Jacksonville, Florida. It was the third bowl trip in 4 years, and the players approached this game with a relaxed and confident attitude. After the players filled up on Southern hospitality, they got lean, mean, and hungry to take on the South Carolina Gamecocks. For the players, being invited to the Gator Bowl was a tribute to Coach Pat Jones's leadership.
He brought the best out of all of us. You know, for his first year, he did what a lot of coaches only dream of doing, and some of his dreams came true, like he said, and right here in the Gator Bowl, that's one of them that is coming true. So, you know, I give him all the credit in the world. A workaholic he is, but a winner he is also.
The American flag was flown in, and an ABC television audience, as well as a Gator Bowl record 82,000 fans, set back to watch the top 10 matchup. OSU stopped the first Carolina drive cold on 3 plays and then took over the ball. Rusty Hilger led his team downfield on a well-conceived 12-play drive that was capped with this Thurman Thomas touchdown dive. The second quarter opened with Ricky Adams' timely fumble recovery. Led by the passing of Rusty Hilger and the running of Thurman Thomas, the Cowboys staged an impressive 15-play drive that was capped with a little razzle-dazzle. The point after try sailed wide, and the defense was called in to preserve the 13-0 lead. They responded by mounting a full-scale assault on the Gamecock quarterback. Rodney Harding had a field day as he made a great sack and then recovered 2 fumbles. As Thurman Thomas was piling up 155 yards en route to the most valuable player honors, the Gamecocks took a 14-13 lead. Time wound down in the fourth quarter, and it looked as if the lead might hold up. With 3:41 remaining on the clock, the Cowboys were 88 yards from the goal line. Coach Pat Jones had told his quarterback that it was 4 downs all the way. Rusty took the offensive reins, and he knew that it was now or never. He hit Terry Weimer near the sideline, and Terry made the extra effort to get the first down. 2 pass completions quickly moved the ball to near midfield. 4 plays later, Barry Hanna made a clutch catch on a 4th and 6 to keep the drive alive. Thurman Thomas picked up 10 more on a draw play. On the Carolina 25, Barry Hanna's number was called again, and the rest is history. Hanna's dramatic individual effort put OSU ahead, and Jamie Harris's 2-point conversion catch made the final score 21-14. With their 7th bowl win in 9 appearances, the Cowboys finished the season rated as high as 5th in the nation. But to their fans, they were number one. The sweet taste of success in 1984 was shared by every player, coach, and fan, and will be remembered as long as the Cowboy spirit lives.